Jayurada Madhava Kunjabi Hari. Jayurada Madhava Kunjabi Hari. Gopi jana balava girivade dhari. Gopi jana balava girivade dhari.
Gopi jana balava.
Yamuna Tira Vanachari
From a letter dated 1968, March. I am in due receipt of your letter, dated March 21st, 1968, and may inform you that the horrible scene in the hospital is certainly ghastly, but we should at the same time know that this ghastly scene is in the matter of the bodily concept of life. This is Maya's illusion, and although the spirit soul has nothing to do with these horrible affairs, and due to absorption of one's consciousness in the body, one has to suffer the consequences of bodily identification. So far we are concerned, we shall neither be sympathetic nor apathetic in the matter of such bodily concept of life. Of course, it is quite natural to become sympathetic when one's body is put into such horrible condition. But if you are firmly convinced that this body is separate from the soul, then we may not be distracted. That is not possible, of course, in the preliminary stage, but when we shall be in the transcendental position, not to be disturbed by every such a horrible scene, then our position is secure. The suffering of the man and the sympathy of the other man, both are concerned on the body, but this we have to understand by knowledge. Then such horrible condition of body won't be disturbing to us. That is the position of liberation. Doesn't mean we shall not be sympathetic to one who is suffering, but we should always remember that such sufferings are due to the bodily concept of life. As you stated, that you simply want to leave the material world and be with Krishna, that is the best position, rather than taking account of how things happened that you came here. Like that, our best occupation is to get out of the scene by constantly chanting Hare Krishna and being engaged in the transcendental service of Lord Krishna. You know, I don't know what this is in reference to. Somehow, does anybody know what this letter was? Remember, was reading anything about it from Lilamrita in 68? Something to do that happened with a devotee in, who was in the hospital. But as usual, Prabhupada's compassion is there by helping this devotee to understand both how to look at things now and how we should look at things from a transcendental perspective. Although we may not be on that level of realization, this is another example of jnana and vijnana. Jnana means to theoretically understand, I'm not this body, and vijnana means to realize, I'm not this body. And Prabhupada says, for those who realize, they're not distracted by these things. We often quote that verse from the Bhagavatam, Padashriya Kata Mishta Shinvanti Kati Yanti Cha, engaged in always hearing and chanting about me. Sadhus do not suffer from material miseries because they're always filled with my thoughts and activities and pastimes in this world. Well, Lord Kapila Dev states that for those who are always absorbed in Krishna, thoughts of Krishna, remembering Krishna, speaking about Krishna, they don't suffer from these material miseries, although the experience of the suffering may still be there, but because they've transcended. In fact, I think Prabhupada talks about it, and it's talked about in the Bhagavatam, in this reference to Dhruva Maharaj, how Dhruva Maharaj, at the time of preparing himself to go back to the Vaikuntha spiritual world, he completely detached himself from the body and then at that point did not experience anything in connection with the body, and therefore when death personified appeared before him, which ordinarily would be a very disastrous event for the soul who identifies with the body, Rupa Maharaj, having already been detached from his physical body, simply stepped on the head of death personified and used a step to enter into the flower airplane. So we have to come to that stage, Iha Yasya Hareya Dasye Kamana Manasagira. Anyone who's completely engaged in devotional service, body, mind, and words, he's already a liberated soul, even while within the body. So Prabhupada points that, yes, that for those who are on that platform, they're not distracted by these things. But he says, until we get to that point, still we'll feel sympathy for those who have to suffer. And not only that, but sometimes we may have to try to help others who may not have fully realized, but still are endeavoring to realize. We help them by helping them to overcome their physical pain and to teach them how to do the best that they can, as Prabhupada states in the seventh canto of the Bhagavatam. It is the duty for one who still associates with the material body to do whatever is necessary to heal the body. But ultimately, when all efforts are made and still there is pain, still there may be suffering, then the devotee must at that point come to realize that we have to depend on Krishna's will ultimately for either become relieved from pain or to become detached, or even more so, to get the spiritual body, which doesn't have to undergo the physical pain. If that's Krishna's decision, then at least by completely, fully depending on Krishna's will, we'll be able to accept Krishna's decision when the time comes for Krishna to decide. So this is Prabhupada. In this particular letter, this is what he's doing. He's speaking for those who are realized, and for those who are not sufficiently realized, then it's natural to feel sympathy towards a horrible situation and physical pain. Okay. We'll go on to Srimad Bhagavatam.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 4, Chapter 12. Text 40.
Mahimanam vilokyasya narado bhagavan rishi atodyam vina.
Oh, excuse me, that's not there, is it?
Vitudan shlokan satre agayat pachetasam mahimanam vilokyasya narado bhagavan rishi atodyam vitudan shlokan satre gayat prachetasam mahimanam vilokyasya narado bhagavan rishi atodyam vitudan shlokan satre gayat prachetasam mahimanam vilokyasya narado bhagavan rishi Atodyam vitudan shlokan. Satrigayat prachetasam.
Mahimanam. Glories. Vilokya. Observing. Asya. Of Dhruva Maharaj. Narada. The great sage Narada. Bhagavan. Equally as exalted as the Supreme Personality of Godhead.
Rishi.
The saint.
Atodyam.
The stringed instrument.
Veena.
Vitudan. Playing on. Shlokan. Verses. Satre. In the sacrificial arena. Agayat. Chanted. Prachetasam. Of the Prachetas. Translation. After observing the glories of Dhruva Maharaj, the great sage Narada, playing his veena, went to the sacrificial arena of the Prachetas and very happily chanted the following three verses. Repeat. After observing the glories of Dhruva Maharaj, the great sage Narada, playing his veena, went to the sacrificial arena of the Prachetas and very happily chanted the following three verses. Purport. The great sage Narada was the spiritual master of Dhruva Maharaj. Certainly he was very glad to see Dhruva's glories. As a father is very happy to see the son's advancement in every respect, so the spiritual master is very happy to observe the ascendancy of his disciple.
Mahimanam vilokyasya narado bhagavan shi atto dyam vitudan shlokan satre gaya pachetasam.
After observing the glories of Dhruva Maharaj, the great sage Narada, playing his veena, went to the sacrificial arena of the Prachetas and very happily chanted the following three verses. Om Agyana Timarandasya Gananjana Salakaya Chakshu Unminitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Mukam Karoti Vachalam Pangam Langayate Yarim Yat Kripa Tamaham Vande Shri Gurundina Tananam Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Shimate Bhakti Vedanta Saman Iti Namane Namaste Saraswati Devi Gauravani Pacharane Nyavashesha Sanyavari Paschachade Satarane Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shiva Siddhi Gaura Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama. So, in this verse, Maitreya Rishi is describing Narada's Muni's reaction to Dhruva Maharaj's accomplishments, his achievements. He is very happy. And Prabhupada, in the commentary, explains and uses the example, which he many times uses, of a parent who is very happy to see the progress of a child. In the same way, the spiritual master, what pleases him is when he sees the disciple making spiritual progress, or in Dhruva Maharaj's case, perfection. In other words, it's what the spiritual master, his intention was from the very outset in accepting the disciple, instructing the disciple, and what he wants to see as an offering from the disciple, that what pleases him the most is his progress. I thought of many places. One that came to my mind, Prabhupada talks about this, is in Chaitanya Charitamrita. I wanted to read this, and then we'll speak more. But he uses the same, either I got to get it repaired or get another one. But forgive me. It has a mind of its own, and sometimes it decides to go crazy. Let's see if we can get it back. Okay. Lord Chaitanya is speaking to Prakashananda Saraswati. And Prakashananda Saraswati, as we know of a conversation, he was asking him, why is it that you don't study Vedanta with us? Why are you behaving like a sentimentalist? You only seem to be interested in one thing. You tunnel vision, so to speak. You seem to be only concerned about one thing only. But in order to really have a healthy spiritual life, like we do, you should be studying Vedanta with us. And Lord Chaitanya, of course, gave the famous answer that, my spiritual master considered me a fool. And he said, you can't study Vedanta. You won't be able to understand. And of course, Lord Chaitanya was taking that position in order to properly instruct Prakashananda Saraswati that what he was missing out in his study of Vedanta. You're studying all the Vedanta, but yet you haven't understood the goal of the Vedanta. So Lord Chaitanya is therefore taking the position that my spiritual master, Ishwara Puri, he instructed me, forget about Vedanta. My instruction to you is chant Hare Krishna, and all Vedanta will be understood. So he said that my spiritual master said, in this way, just simply chant the holy name of the Lord. And therefore, because I have faith in the words of my spiritual master, I understood his intention behind it, and therefore I very faithfully took up his order, and I began with single-pointedness, chanting Hare Krishna, Krishna's name. And then, in due course of time, Lord Chaitanya explained that I began to experience an attraction for the name. I actually forgot. I became unaware of my surroundings. And not only that, but then I began behaving like a madman. And I went back to my spiritual master, in fact, and I presented the whole thing to him and said, what have you given me? What kind of name have you given me? And in this verse, Lord Chaitanya is speaking. He says, chanting the holy name in ecstasy causes me to dance, laugh, and cry. When my spiritual master heard all this, he smiled. Just as Narada Muni became happy when he saw Dhruva Maharaj's perfection. So Ishwara Puri, Lord Chaitanya is saying to Prakashananda, my spiritual master smiled and then began to speak. And Prabhupada says in the purport, when a disciple very perfectly makes progress in spiritual life, this gladdens the spiritual master, who then also smiles in ecstasy, thinking, how successful my disciple has become. He feels so glad that he smiles as he enjoys the progress of the disciple, just as a smiling parent enjoys the activities of a child who's trying to stand up or crawl perfectly. Again, Prabhupada is using the analogy of spiritual masters like a parent. The parent is very happy to see the child make progress. There's another quote in this connection, in the same chapter. Oh, don't do that. It's misbehaving again. Sorry. I'll get it. So, in this commentary, Prabhupada... Oh, please. Ishwarpuri is speaking to Lord Chaitanya. It is very good, my dear child, that you have attained the supreme goal of life by developing love of Godhead. Thus you have pleased me very much, and I am very much obliged to you. Purport, according to the revealed scriptures, if a spiritual master can convert even one soul into a perfectly pure devotee, his mission in life is fulfilled. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur always used to say, even at the expense of all the properties, temples, and mats that I have, if I could convert even one person into a pure devotee, my mission would be fulfilled. It is very difficult, however, to understand the science of Krishna or to speak of developing love of Godhead. Therefore, if by the grace of Lord Chaitanya and the spiritual master, a disciple attains the standard of pure devotional service, the spiritual master is very happy. Spiritual master is not actually happy if the disciple brings him money, but when he sees that a disciple is following the regulative principles and advancing in spiritual life, he is very glad and feels obliged to such an advanced disciple. So, again, Prabhupada is explaining what is it that makes the spiritual master happy. Is the disciple's progress in spiritual life. And he gives the example of, as we said, of the parent. In other places, Prabhupada, he states that, I think it was in pastime of Lord Shiva, when Lord Shiva punished Prajapati Daksha and at the sacrifice, Prabhupada explained in the commentary there are two types of punishment. One type of punishment is like the conqueror who conquers his enemy, and the other type of punishment is like the father who punishes his son. And he says that sometimes the father may chastise the son, but the father always has the welfare of the son at heart. And the father is always thinking, always he wants to see how the son can learn the proper lesson so the son can grow up and become a proper representative of the father. So he says sometimes it is necessary for the spiritual master to punish the disciple just as the father may punish the son. In other words, again, the analogy is there that the parent is always thinking that the child, I have to think of his ultimate welfare, his ultimate benefit. What is it that will please the parent? It's not just that the child becomes wealthy, becomes materially happy, but a good parent is someone who is thinking about the spiritual welfare of the child. Just like this brings to mind, actually, an event that just happened a couple of days ago. I don't know if you heard about this. It happened in Lithuania. And it's just 2 days ago. It's an interesting story. I have a disciple, householder couple, and they have one daughter. I think she's probably 13 years old, approximately 13 years old. So just 2 days ago, she had to go to school as she normally does every morning. And usually they take her to school. One of them takes her to school, but it just so happened in this particular morning, one of them was at the temple at Srimad Bhagavatam class, and the other one, I can't remember the father where he was. So she walked to school that morning. And while she was walking to school, I don't remember the sequence of the events, but I remember most of the details. While she was walking to school, she called her father and said, "Dad, somebody's following me." And she was really concerned. And then all of a sudden, while she was talking to her father, click, phone was off, nothing. And then the father, of course, was concerned, thinking, "Only child, what's happened?" And so he called the school and asked if his daughter had arrived yet. The school said no, and said, "If my daughter arrives, please notify me right away." No notification. So he called the police department. And then he had to give a full report, give the details of where his daughter was walking, the way she usually walks to school. And then he didn't know what to do. So police were informed, school was informed. So the first thing he thought of is, "I should go before Lord Nrisimhadev." And he began praying before Lord Nrisimhadev, saying that, "I have brought this child into this world as an offering to you. She belongs to you. She's currently under my care and is my responsibility. And I know it is my duty to see that she becomes a pure devotee in this life. If you so desire, please allow me to continue my service and allow me to offer my daughter to you so that she will serve you and dedicate her life completely in your service." And he just prayed. Didn't know what else to do. Prayed to Lord Nrisimhadev. As a father thinks of the spiritual welfare of the child, "She's not mine." In fact, we oftentimes think of that quote from Srila Bhaktisiddhanta, where he says that the spiritual vision means that one should see one's children as Krishna's friends. One's parents as Krishna's parents. And one should see all women as to be enjoyed by Krishna. This is spiritual vision. So he was praying in this way. And then after praying, shortly afterwards, he got a phone call from his daughter. And I don't know how much time had transpired, but the daughter began to explain what happened. And she was on her way home. What had happened is that morning, she was a little late, so she took a shortcut and she walked off the main path. Somebody was following her. She was kidnapped. And the kidnapper took her on the outskirts of the city and to meet another man who was going to appraise her as to if she would be suitable for their schemes, whatever it was. And then she was screaming and screaming, so the kidnappers took her to the river, put her into the water and didn't want to drown her, but tried to stop her from screaming and put her on, held her underwater. And then they brought her back into the car where they met another man who was appraising her. And at that time, which was, who knows how close it was to the time he was praying to Lord Nrisingadev, one gentleman came by with a combat dog. And it was a dog they use in the military, probably a big, ferocious German Shepherd. And she was in the car locked up while the two gentlemen who had kidnapped her were sitting outside smoking cigarettes waiting to transfer her. And the man walked by and she started screaming. And the man looked in the car, saw your little girl, and turned to the two men sitting by the car smoking cigarettes and said, if you don't let this girl out of the car immediately, this moment, this dog will eat both of you for lunch. And the dog was quite capable, evidently, of doing it. The two men realized that there's nothing they could do. They let her out, the man with the dog, put her in the car, asked her who she was, where she lived, and drove her home, and brought her home safely. Govinda, Ashwini Kumar's daughter. Amazing. So, anyways, this just happened 2 days ago. I'm waiting for more details. I wanted to make sure if these two men were apprehended or not. But anyways, this is how he felt. I brought this child into this world. She belongs to you. My service isn't complete. If you so wish me to continue my service and make my offering to you, then please bring her back to me so that I can continue my service and offer her to you. And Lord Nrisingadev desired to protect and manifested himself, not as a half man, half lion, but this time as a ferocious dog. And so this is how the parent feels towards the child. That parent is always thinking of the ultimate interest of the child. Not that she's meant for my pleasure, she's meant to serve me, or he's meant to serve me, but I want to see this living entity who I've brought into this world become your servant. And if I can serve you, and serving in this way by bringing her to, or him to your lotus feet, so they can perfect their lives in service to you and achieve spiritual perfection, this will be my happiness. So if a parent, of course, thinks like that, then this is actually the thinking of the welfare of the child. This is genuine welfare of the child. And Prabhupada oftentimes, we said, uses the example of the parent towards the child, using that same analogy of the spiritual master towards the disciple. In other words, the spiritual master doesn't want anything from the disciple for himself. There's a very nice quote from Srila Bhaktisiddhanta. And this is in Amrita Vani. I read this quote recently, where Srila Bhaktisiddhanta says what the spiritual master wants from the disciple. Just as Prabhupada just said, the spiritual master is more interested in the advancement of the disciple than he is in collecting money from the disciple. This is not what the spiritual master considers this to be the best service that could be rendered. And Srila Bhaktisiddhanta makes a similar point in one quote here in his teachings of Amrita Bani. He says, we can understand the Vaishnava philosophy if we possess three specific qualities: unconditional surrender, honest inquiry, and a serving temperament. The teachers of Vaishnava philosophy instruct those who approach an acharya to render these three qualities as dakshina. The acharyas are not tempted by mundane dakshina. This is Srila Bhaktisiddhanta's statement also. Here saying that what does a spiritual master want is dakshina? Well, he says here, dakshina means surrender, unconditional surrender, not to Krishna, unconditional surrender to Krishna. An honest inquiry, honest, relevant inquiry, how do I make progress? How do I actually become surrendered? This is honest inquiry. And a serving temperament. Serving temperament means that the proper serving temperament is to please. As Krishna or as Rupa Goswami explains in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, that devotional service rendered to Krishna must be rendered with the intent to please. And if we understand what is it that pleases the spiritual master, well, Prabhupada has stated here in today's verse, in the verses we've already quoted, and in examples that we've already given, that with the intent, if we have the intention to please, then we should want to make our life as an offering to the spiritual master, which is, how can I advance in spiritual life? This is what pleases him. He becomes happy. Narada Muni becomes very happy because he's seen that Dhruva Maharaj has perfected his life. He's going back to the spiritual world. He's going to Vishnuloka, which is the fulfillment of the benediction that was given to him. He's transcended the material bodily concept of life. He's engaged in rendering service to the Supreme Lord. And Narada Muni is quite happy that not only is he quite happy, but here in this verse he says he's going to that place, the sacrificial arena of the Prachetas, and he's going to chant three verses glorifying his disciple. He's thinking that, yes, he says that. He said, Dhruva Maharaj, he said, the next verse he says that Narada said, simply by the influence of his spiritual advancement and powerful austerity, Dhruva Maharaj, the son of Suniti, who was devoted to her husband, acquired an exalted position and not possible to attain even for the so-called Vedantists or strict followers of the Vedic principles, not to speak of ordinary human beings. So, this is what makes, as Prabhupada says here, a father is very happy to see the son's advancement in every respect, so the spiritual master is very happy to observe the ascendancy of his disciple. Ascendancy. Ascendancy means what? To have dominion over others, doesn't it? Actually, that's ascendancy. Because actually what's happening in Dhruva Maharaj's case, Dhruva Maharaj is going to become, he's going to have his own planet. He's going to become king. He was king here in this world, but he's going to go to Dhruva Loka, and he's going to achieve dominion over everyone in Dhruva Loka. He'll become the king of that planet, which is also the residence of Lord Vishnu, which was his desire. And when Dhruva Maharaj came before Narada Muni with these desires, it's very interesting. We've been speaking about this topic, that Dhruva Maharaj, he had the desire, because of the insult that he received from his stepmother. His stepmother wouldn't allow him to sit on his father's lap. And she said that the reason why you can't sit on your father's lap is because you didn't take birth from my womb. And don't you know, I'm the favorite of your father. And although your father has two queens, I'm the favorite. And if you want to sit on his lap like your stepbrother is, Uttama, sitting right now, then you'll have to worship the Lord. And if he's kind upon you, He'll let you take birth in your next life from my womb, and then you can sit on his lap. She was very envious, obviously. And Dhruva Maharaj, of course, was very angry. He went to his mother crying, Suniti, and he said, why is it my father's treating me this way? His father didn't even say anything. His father, you know, he was being controlled by the Suruchi, and although he could have said, oh, it's okay, you can come, he didn't say anything. So he's angry at his father, he's angry at his stepbrother, he's angry at his stepmother, and he approached his mother and asked her, why did this happen? And his mother, Suniti, said, actually, it's true. Your father has a favorable attitude more towards your stepmother, Suruchini, than does to me. You'll just have to accept it. But she said, don't think bad of them. Don't try to cause harm to them in any way. Because if you cause harm to them, then you will have to reap the fruit. And the same harm that you think about causing to them, well, you'll have to get that also. Better, like the good mother she was, better you take up the good advice of your stepmother. She said, go to the Lord. So Suniti instructed Dhruva Maharaj that this is what you should do. You should go and you should worship the Supreme Lord. She was actually, Prabhupada explains that Suniti was like becoming a guru for Dhruva Maharaj by instructing her to go and to worship the Lord. So, however, the point is, an important point, is that Dhruva Maharaj was motivated by anger. He was very angry at all three. Angry at his stepbrother, because he got to sit on his father's lap. He's very angry at his stepmother, because she treated him that way. And actually angry at his father, because he didn't say anything. And so for Dhruva Maharaj wanted, at that point, he became very determined. He wanted to get a position which was either better than his father's, better than his grandfather's, Swayambhuva Manu. And then he was thinking, no, I want even better than my great-grandfather, Lord Brahma. I want a position better than him. And with this determination and with the good instruction from his mother, he went to the forest. And then Narada Muni, his spiritual master, who Prabhupada explained, because Narada Muni travels everywhere throughout the universe, he just happened, and he's Trikalagya, he knows past, present, and future, he happened to be aware of Dhruva's situation at that time, and Prabhupada says in the commentary, he didn't have anything else to do at the time. So because he didn't have anything else to do, he just immediately came before Dhruva. He thought, this is a good candidate. Here's a good candidate for a disciple. Very determined boy. He's going off to the forest on the instructions of his mother to find the Supreme Lord. And then he was thinking, I'm going to test him. So he said to Dhruva, well, you should be happy, satisfied, in any condition. This is the symptom of a devotee. The devotee is not disturbed under such circumstances. And therefore, this would be a better position for you to take. Give up your anger and be peaceful. And not only that, but you're a five-year-old boy. Do you realize what it's going to take to see the Supreme Lord? Do you realize the type of mystic yoga and austerities you're going to have to perform to do this, to achieve the Supreme Lord? Why don't you go back and come back
at a later time, when you're a little bit older, when you realize what you're getting yourself into. And Dhruva Maharaj said to Narada Muni, he said, your instructions are very good, but they're not touching my heart. He said, actually, I am very determined to get the fulfillment of my desires. And I'm very determined to see the Supreme Lord. And Prabhupada explains that Narada was testing Dhruva Maharaj's determination. I mean, someone may say, well, he should have just immediately accepted his instruction. What do you mean? I've given you instruction and you're saying your instructions aren't touching my heart? But actually, he was testing the determination because actually what he wanted to see is Dhruva Maharaj's determination. How much determination do you have to see the Supreme Lord? And Dhruva Maharaj showed him, yes, this is my determination. But his determination was still based on not a completely pure motive. It was based on his anger. His determination was, he even said to Narada Muni, he said, I'm a kshatriya. You know, it's in my blood. You can't deter me from my determination. You know? And I want the instructions from you how to see the Supreme Lord. So then, of course, Narada, who had his ultimate interest of his disciple, who wanted to see the best for his disciple, understanding the heart of the disciple, understanding the determination of the disciple, even though that determination may not have been completely purely motivated, it was born of anger. Narada Muni then gave Dhruva Maharaj instructions how to see the Lord. And told him to go to the forest and to, I think, Madhuvan in Vrindavan. And there on the banks of the river, he said, you should perform austerities, mystic yoga, and controlling your intake, your food, your life air, your breathing, and in this way withdraw your senses externally completely, and then meditate on the existence of the Lord within your heart. And when you actually place the Lord there within your heart and fully meditate upon him, you'll get the fulfillment of your desire. And chant this mantra. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. So Narada Muni, blessed, gave all good instruction to Dhruva and said, this is how you can perfect your life. And this is how you get the perfection of your desires, fulfillment of your desires, which was to see the Supreme Lord. So as we know, Dhruva Maharaj took his instructions very seriously and with great determination. He went to the forest, began controlling his mind, his senses, began eating, I think, a little bit some fruits or wild berries every 3 days for the first month. And then the second month, he began eating dried leaves every 6 days. And then in the third month, he gave up eating completely and just controlled his breath. And then in the fourth month, he began breathing, I think, once every few days. And in the fifth month, he controlled his breath and was taking a breath, you know, once every 9 days or something, 12 days or something like that. And after 6 months, he had completely focusing his attention upon the Supreme Lord within his heart and performing these very severe austerities, he created such a disturbance by his austerities that because he was not breathing, he was choking the universe. So that even the demigods in the upper planetary systems were feeling choked by Dhruva Maharaj's austerities. And then the demigods, they approached Lord Brahma. No, they approached the Supreme Lord. I think Vishnu, I think it was. On
the milk ocean. And they described what was happening. And they said, and the Supreme Lord said, well, it looks like I'm going to have to go and do something about this. So on the strength of his austerities and determination, he forced the Lord to come. And Dhruva, at that point, his meditation was on the Lord within the heart. He had already focused his mind, his vision, and saw the Lord within his heart. And then his meditation broke. He opened his eyes, and standing before him was the Supreme Lord. After 6 months. What did the Lord say to Dhruva Maharaj? Interesting what the Lord said. The Lord told Dhruva, Dhruva began offering prayers first. He understood that this, upon seeing the Lord, he offered prayers and began glorifying the Lord, and he actually prayed to the Lord, please give me the association of devotees. He was actually thinking in this way. This was his desire. But after hearing the prayers, the Lord told Dhruva, he said, I've come to fulfill your desires. He said, you will rule the kingdom in this world for, I can't remember how many years, maybe 36,000 years, I think it was. And after ruling the kingdom, you will get your own planet, which is even better than your grandfather's, Lord Brahma. He says, there, in a region of the universe, there is a planet, pole star. And on that planet, the effects of the material universe do not take place. The Lord resides there. It is a Vaikuntha planet within this universe. So even Lord Brahma, who has to die at the end of his life, his planet is not as great as the planet I'm going to give you in this universe. So you'll have a planet and you'll go there. This is the fulfillment of your desire. And then after he says that, the Lord said to Dhruva, and your stepbrother? Your stepfather in the future, while you're ruling in this world, he will go to the forest. He'll be killed in the forest. When your stepmother, Saruchi, hears about it, in anguish, she'll enter into the forest also, looking for him. And she'll be consumed by a forest fire. She will also die. And then, the Lord left. And Dhruva Maharaj, he realized, he said, I can't, what's happened? He said he was thrown into so much lamentation because he was thinking, the Lord came to fulfill my desires that I had in my anger. I could have had so much more. But he only addressed the desires that I had in my anger. My anger towards my stepbrother, my stepmother, and my father, I wanted a kingdom better than his. So he addressed all of those things. And now he's going to think that when I told him I only want association of devotees, he's going to think I was trying to deceive him. And he was lamenting. He was lamenting. Because he said that, in fact, he felt disgust. That why would I think in this way? Of course, and Prabhupada explains in the commentary, he says that for one who is attached due to his excessive attachment becomes angry, he said that he'll have to face the same consequences as Dhruva Maharaj did. And even though one may achieve the association of the Supreme Lord, still he will have to lament due to this attachment and due to this anger. So, and there are many verses. I think there are about 6 verses in that chapter. Dhruva Maharaj returns home, where Dhruva Maharaj expresses his lamentation of how the Lord came before him, fulfilled his desires, and Dhruva was lamenting, I could have asked for anything, but the Lord didn't ask me what I wanted. He just came to and remembered only the things I asked for him before in my anger. And he was so upset with himself. Of course, still, Dhruva Maharaj became purified, nonetheless. And although the lamentation was there, he still remembered the Lord. In fact, the famous prayer, he says, I come here looking for a piece of broken glass. I found the most valuable jewel. And he did achieve a perfected state, achieved the perfection of realm of going back to the spiritual world, to Vaikuntha, to Vishnuloka, who got the Supreme Lord residing on the same planet. Was he gatekeeper? No, that was Bali Maharaj. But he was residing on the same planet as Dhruva. And he associated with the Lord. So Narada Muni, of course, he is the perfect representative, the spiritual master, who becomes very happy to see how Dhruva Maharaj achieved. And another point, very important point, which is brought out in this verse today. I think the word is there. Bhagavan, what is it? Yes, Bhagavan. It's right in the verse. The verse is Mahimanam Velokasya Narado Bhagavan Rishi. And Bhagavan is translated as equally as exalted as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So the spiritual master, Narada Muni in this case, he is equally exalted as the Supreme Lord. And therefore, being the representative of the Lord, he wants for his disciple the same as what the Supreme Lord would want from the devotee. We oftentimes explain a very important point to how the Supreme Lord has no interest of anything material from his devotee. The Lord is only interested in the devotee's love. And although the Lord may ask something from the devotee, the Lord is not asking because the Lord has any need, derives any benefit, has any interest. None of these things whatsoever. The Lord only wants love. And he wants to give that love. He wants to share that love. He wants the devotee to experience the same experience of pleasure that he experiences. And that pleasure is achieved through service to him. So the Lord doesn't want service to him for his benefit. The Lord wants service to him for the living entity's benefit. Because when the living entity gets the opportunity to serve the Lord, he experiences the same pleasure and happiness as the Lord. The Lord is not like a hard taskmaster who's looking for slaves. He's already fully satisfied. He's already fully atmarama aptakama, self-satisfied. Therefore, why does he want service? For them. Because that service is so great, so pleasurable, such an amazing experience that even the Lord himself wants to experience it. And oftentimes, and it's described in Chaitanya Charitamrita, that the Lord would ask, what is it that the devotees are experiencing? They seem to be getting a pleasure that is even greater than the pleasure I have in serving them, their service to me seems to be giving them a pleasure even greater than the service, than the pleasure I get. What is it? What is that pleasure? I want to know. But how can I know? Because I'm God. How can I know? Therefore, he said, I want to become a devotee so I can experience the pleasure that they're experiencing by serving me. That's how great the pleasure is in serving the Lord. And it's no wonder why the Lord wants the devotee to serve him. Not for himself, but for, to give that devotee an opportunity to get that pleasure. Therefore, it's described the greatest benediction that one can get from the Lord is the benediction of pure devotional service. It can't be gotten by any other means except by mercy of the Lord or by the mercy of the devotee of the Lord. Therefore, Narada Muni, being Bhagavan, as good as the exalted Supreme Personality of Godhead, his interest was to see Dhruva Maharaj get devotional, pure devotional service to the Supreme Lord. And therefore, when he sees Dhruva Maharaj, just sees, look, he's going back to Vishnu Loka. He's so happy. One should not think that to satisfy the spiritual master, as we read from Srila Bhakti Siddhanta, what is the dakshina? It's not the monetary service, it's not the bodily service, although that may be there. It's to develop, it's to cultivate the service attitude. That actually, what is it that my spiritual master would be most pleased with? And as Lord Chaitanya told Prakashananda Saraswati, my spiritual master was most pleased when he saw me advancing in spiritual life. This is my offering to him. And therefore, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta says, the dakshina that one gives the spiritual master is the unconditional surrender. It's the service temperament. What was the third? Honest inquiry. Yes, honest inquiry. Honest inquiry. The honest inquiry is, how can I please Krishna? How can I become a servant? This is dakshina. This is what's pleasing. And it's no wonder Narada Muni became very pleased with Dhruva Maharaj, because Dhruva Maharaj, with great determination, followed his instruction and became completely purified in heart and achieved perfection. And therefore, as Prabhupada says here, the father is very happy to see the son's advancement in every respect, so the spiritual master is very happy to observe the ascendancy of his disciple. So, any questions? Okay. Hare Krishna, we'll end. All glories to Shri Prabhupada.